Hi there. My name is Morgan Hicks. I'm the Director of Education and Program Development at Theater Squared, and this is another episode of the Play On series at Theater Squared, where we're offering videos as outreach to students and teachers. So this one's going to be focused mostly for our teacher friends. I'm going to be doing a demo of some of the Zoom features that we might be able to incorporate in any kind of public performance that we're trying to plan in that virtual realm. So I know that some of us are going to go back face-to-face sooner than others, but a lot of us are sort of planning our backup plan and other ways to be able to showcase our students' work. And so I am not an expert on Zoom. I don't know everything there is to know, and I'm sure that I'm going to be still discovering things as we go, but I have heard from a lot of people that they're just sort of getting frustrated with trying to reinvent the wheel, and they just want somebody to share anything that they've discovered so far. And so that's what I'm going to be attempting to do. I'm going to have a stage manager jump on with me here in a second. I'm also going to have some student actors who are willing to be our guinea pig for this demo. And for this demo, we're just going to be using a public domain radio play because we didn't really want to focus on the content. We were really just trying to take a tour around the features, looking at how to get actors in and out of screen and sort of just how to manage this virtual room. Okay, so first there are some things that we need to look at in the settings to kind of set us up for success. So I will pop into these settings and show you what I know. Okay, here we are in the homepage of our Zoom app, and this is the homepage of the Zoom app that you've downloaded onto your computer, not the online portal. And you want to go up to the settings tab here, and you're going to get lots of options of how you want to inhabit your Zoom space. The ones that we're really going to focus on are going to be the video and audio. So you want to make sure that your participants are all clicking the same thing so that you have consistency across your Zooms. In the video, you're going to want to make sure that they've selected the correct camera, that you've got the widescreen option, and then you're enabling the HD. If they have HD cameras, you want the highest quality picture. You can mirror your video and kind of swap that around here. And you know, touch up the appearance, get a little filter on there, not mad about that. The ones that we really want to make sure that we focus on, though, are going to be down here in the meetings. You want to make sure that they turn off the video when they're joining the meeting. That's going to help if they get kicked out of the meeting for some reason and have to re-enter. Maybe they have bad Wi-Fi and they get kicked out and have to come back. You don't want them busting on in with their video on and showing up into a scene where they don't necessarily belong. You also want to give them that extra security of clicking the always show video preview dialog. That's going to remind them if they have their video on. And then the most important for sharing a performance or showcase is going to be that you hide non-video participants. So everyone needs to do that, hide non-video participants. And that's going to mean that if a student has their camera or a participant has their camera turned off, then they're not going to show up on the screen at all. That's going to be the difference of having them disappear or having a box there with their name on it or their silhouette. So we really don't want that. We don't want to be reminded that there are other people in the scene that are just spectators and not participants. So we want to hide those non-video people. And that's going to give your stage manager or you a lot more control over who's on the screen at any given time. Then in the audio settings, you're just going to want to test the speaker quality and the microphone for everyone. Microphones on computers can cause all kinds of problems, so you want to kind of walk through those. Sometimes people have them really loud, so you want to get kind of a level set that's consistent. And you also want to make sure that the students know where their microphones on their computers are, so that they're not muffling those or inadvertently putting something on top of them to ruin their sound quality. You want to make sure that you have everyone click mute my microphone when joining the meeting so that they don't come in and with all of their ambient sounds happening. And this is a fun shortcut, the press and hold space key to temporarily unmute yourself. Even when you're muted in a meeting, you can push that space bar down if you have this clicked, and you can have your microphone turned on for a the period of time that you have it held down. So that's fun if you have some students that are running sound or doing something like that, or they're just talking in a scene but don't necessarily need to come onto the scene. So they can run that shortcut and not need the stage manager or you to unmute their sound for them. In the share screen, you want to silence your system notifications so that you don't have any bells and whistles going off. And then in chat as well, you want to make sure that you have the do not disturb on for the duration of your meeting and muting notifications. The virtual backgrounds are really fun. If you click none, that's your real space that we're seeing. You can have the students get creative with lighting or something three-dimensional for their backgrounds. You can also use images. Zoom gives us some images and some videos, or you can create your own and you can add those by clicking on here, add image or video, and add a JPEG or a movie file or something like that. You can get really, really creative with those. We went ahead and found some royalty-free images online and pulled those down to use for our play. You wanna go ahead and send those to the students in advance usually and have them download them and have them load them up in their virtual background library so they can pull them pretty easily. You can also just do solid colors by creating a JPEG that's just a square of a solid color, or you can have the students create their own and do something like that. The virtual backgrounds are not flawless. You can run into some problems if you have a slower processing speed on your computer, so they can be really glitchy and weird. One workaround is if you click the I have a green screen and you do a green fabric backdrop or green butcher block paper or a green wall or something like that, and that can work really well and kind of help solve that problem of the glitchiness. The thing that I like about the virtual backgrounds is that you give the student an option of protecting their privacy. They may not have a lot of control over what's happening in their environment. And so the virtual backgrounds can give them a little bit of level of privacy and protection. And so I think it's a good thing to be able to offer to the students as an option. In the recording, you want to make sure that you know where your video is going to go. You can either set it up to go to a certain folder, or you can send it to the cloud and then you'll just download it later. And that's a good option if you don't have a whole lot of memory on your computer. Okay, and so that's basically what's happening in the settings. Okay. So once you're in your meeting, you can also make some setting changes. If you click here, you can mute participants on entry. Say yes. You can tell people that they're allowed to unmute themselves or rename themselves. That could be something that you decide if you want your character names or your actor names there. I'm going to let Anna, my stage manager, in. There she is. Hey!
Hello!
How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm so good. Okay, so I'm trying to do a demo and trying to kind of like take a tour around some of the features. And one of the things that I was trying to figure out is if I can give you control over, if I can make you a co-host.
Okay.
Let me see if that's something it lets me do here. So if I click on make you a host.
Yeah, I'm looking. Oh, yes. Little notification that says you are the host now.
Fantastic. Okay. So as the host, then you can have sort of the power of who is on the screen and who's not on the screen. And I can make myself invisible and I can record the screen for performance, right? So you'll be actually running things backstage and I'll be sort of hosting the version that would be public view. So it's good to have two different people kind of running the rehearsal and then running performance.
Yeah.
After Anna and I talked through her role as a stage manager a little bit, we brought the actors in from the virtual waiting room. We had them in a breakout room and we invited them all in and looked at the backdrops with them to try to figure out if we could make that work. We found that some of the actors did have slower processing speeds on their computers. And so like Annie down there in the bottom left, we couldn't quite get it to work and we didn't have time to source out a green screen for her. So we just went with a blank wall. We found the transitions work best if the stage manager is in charge of turning the cameras on and the audio on for the actors as they start the scenes, and then letting the actors be in charge of turning their own cameras off and muting themselves. So that we found to be the most seamless transitions is that if the stage manager could bring them in and remember that they have their hide non-video participants clicked, so they're going to be invisible, she's going to bring them in and they're going to take themselves out. That way she's not trying to do two different things at once, not trying to start the scene and end the scene at the same time.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Allow us to bring you at this time another mystery drama from real life. Tonight we will unfold the story of Boston's lone wolf terror, adapted from Startling Detective Adventures magazine. How helpless women cowered in terror as a wolf-like phantom swooped down on the city of Boston. Taunting the police with their inability to trap him, he continued on his meteoric way until one day this lone wolf was brought to bay. As the curtain rises, we find Miss Betsy Mack in her apartment about to retire for the night when the telephone rings.
Oh, hello, Grace. What's the trouble? What? You left your pocketbook here? Where did you leave it? On the piano? Oh, all right. I'll bring it to you when we meet for lunch tomorrow. Good night.
I beg your pardon. Don't scream, please. If you do, it will only cause a lot of trouble for everybody.
Who are you and what do you want?
Permit me to introduce myself. I am the Lone Wolf.
Okay, so what we're seeing here now, this sort of pixelization and distortion and out-of-sync voices and mouths is going to be caused by a slow Wi-Fi signal. And truly, this is going to be the hardest thing to solve. They're not seeing any problem on their end. It's about the uploading and the Wi-Fi signal. So this is going to be something that you're going to try to get the student to get as close as possible to their modem or their router so that they get a stronger signal, or even better if they can plug in and hardwire into that modem or Ethernet, use the Ethernet. This is going to be the tricky thing because not everybody has this high-speed internet and not everybody really needs it for what they usually do at home. I've read that what you're looking for is a minimum of 8 Mbps up-down in order to get the cleanest signal, and this could be probably one of the hardest challenges that we're going to face here in this setting.
Then I'll have to tie you up while I go through the apartment.
You wouldn't dare.
Oh, wouldn't I? Well, I'll show you.
You fiend! You devil!
I guess that will keep you quiet for a while. Now to start on my treasure hunt. I'll begin with your bureau. Ah, yes. Here is your pocketbook. Let's see what's in it. My, this is luck. $150 and a lovely wristwatch.
Why do you do these things? Breaking into people's homes? Robbing them?
Why? Because I get a kick out of it.
Okay, now we're getting close to a transition, so our stage manager, Anna, is getting ready to activate the cameras for the actors, Trey and Landon, who are about to come onto screen, and Jake and Annie, who have been in the scene, are going to be blocking their own cameras to exit the scene.
Now, I hate to do this, but I've got to gag you because I've got to get some sleep.
Won't you please just go away?
Not until morning. Can't take any chances. Where's the light switch? Ah, here it is. Well, pleasant dreams.
Okay, that transition went pretty well. The issue now in this scene that we're looking at is inconsistent lighting. So Landon has a pretty well-lit face. He's got a good front light and overhead light, it looks like, probably in natural light. Trey, the angle that he's at, he's getting a lot of shadowing on one side of his face. It looks like his light source is only on his right side. And so what we would want to do is try to find a way to get better front light for Trey, and then also overhead light. The combination of those two things would help out a lot. You can play around with windows, with artificial light, with bouncing light off of walls or pillows, things like that, or even mirrors. So that's something that we would probably want to play around with if we had a little bit longer on this piece to try to get them some consistent lighting.
Pulls a job, and they always end the article by saying, "Where's the police?"
Gee, Aunt Agnes, that was a good show tonight, wasn't it?
Yes, Caroline, that was the best play I've seen in a long time.
Okay, so the issue here is going to be a sound issue. Tori on the right has pretty good sound quality, but Anna is getting a lot of echoing and distortion. So that's going to be something that you're going to want to tech through with her, with your actor, to see if you can make some adjustments in the settings for her sound so that her microphone is picking up a better sound quality for her and it's a little bit more consistent. And then when we saw Jake enter the scene there, we did see a little bit of ghosting of that silhouette. That's something that maybe you'd want to try to tech a little bit more with your stage manager to make sure that that you've got control over that. Or it could be that this is just something that's very, very hard to accomplish in Zoom Live, and that you're going to benefit from just going ahead and recording it and then employing some editing software to clean some of those transitions up.
Now wait just 1 minute. Yes, I rob women, but only because I enjoy their company.
If you don't get out of here right away, I'll scream.
If you do, you'll be sorry. You little devil, I ought to kill you for that.
No, no, please don't.
Hello, Chief, I've been waiting for you. We heard back from the fingerprint test we set off. This crook's name is James Walters. He was given a dishonorable discharge from the Navy for a fraudulent enlistment. They also sent us a picture. The newspapers are already carrying the story with an appeal for every reader to watch for him and instantly notify the nearest policeman if they see him. We've got him now, Chief.
I hope so. Hello? Yes, madam, this is the Chief of Police speaking. What's that? You recognize a picture of the lone wolf. Well, do you know where he lives? On Wendell Street in South Boston. He's what? Married, eh?
And stage manager Anna is prepping for one of the more complicated transitions. She's going to be taking the chief out, leaving the inspector in, and then she's going to be bringing in the wolf and his wife. That was a little tricky. And here we're going to look at one final issue in the recording. It's going to be this bounce on the glasses. Okay, so this is something that you definitely want to look at with all of your actors who wear glasses and see how you can get the light sources to not be reflective onto the panes of their glasses. You just don't want to have that telltale sign that they're looking at the screen. And that's going to be sort of one of the final things that we would look at if we were going to be preparing this for a showcase.
Well, Inspector, I've had a lot of fun. I suppose I'll be in the headlines. Lone wolf trapped at last. Do you know, I'll enjoy reading it. Goodbye, dear.
Oh, Jim.
Come on.
With pleasure.
And so the curtain falls on another truly startling and completely true criminal tale. Until next week at the same time, we bid you good night.
I want to thank our stage manager, Anna Colley, and all of our amazing actors for being so willing to jump on to this last minute Zoom meeting and showcase all of the things that could go wrong in a showcase. I know that I don't know everything there is to know about Zoom. I'm not trying to pretend that I do. And I'm sure that there are some solutions to these things that I haven't thought of yet. So if you want to jump into the comments and tell us some of your tips and tricks, that would be amazing. This is all just, you know, some virtual space that we're trying to navigate together. And hopefully us spending a little bit of time on it today will save you a little bit of time with your students in the future. So thanks for joining us for this episode of Play On, and we hope to see you again soon, and hopefully very soon at the theater.